Okay, done.
Good afternoon. Today is the 24th of January of 2021. My name is Samantha Villarreal. I am an interviewer for UTSA Oral History Research Project over COVID-19 and the impact it had in our San Antonio community. This project is directed by Dr. Whitney Chapo. Our guest today is Noel Montenegro. Thank you for giving us your time. Can you tell us a little bit more about yourself?
Sure. So at the current moment in this time period, I am 24 years old. I am a teacher here in San Antonio, Texas. I teach English at one of the high schools. I graduated from UTSA in 2019. And I am originally from El Paso, Texas, but this is where I call home now.
How long have you been teaching?
Actually, a couple years. This is actually my second year. Nice. This is like my cat Catalina. Sorry, she might be making a couple appearances, but I've been teaching for a couple years. This is my second year right now, so I actually started my first year right before the pandemic started. So the end of my first year was when the pandemic started.
Catalina. And how was that experience or that change?
It was very, very, very rough at first. You know, we had to basically switch completely to online learning within the span of like a week and a half or so. And you know, none of us were really prepared because it's very uncharted territory. But you know, we did the best we could. A lot of it was just kind of like checking up on our students to make sure that like they like were doing okay. So it was kind of it felt like a really weird time. I didn't really feel like I got to do as much as I really wanted to as a teacher, you know?
And what is your family life like? Did it change when you moved to El Paso or did it stay pretty much the same?
You mean, did it change when I moved to San Antonio?
Yes.
I'm from El Paso, yeah. So it did change a little bit, you know, obviously, you know, I'm not living in the same city anymore. So, you know, I don't talk to my family as much as I used to, but, you know, I always make sure to call them. During the pandemic, we obviously called a lot more often because, you know, what else was there to do? But yeah, no, I mean, we, you know, I still go to visit them at least two or three times a year. So it doesn't really feel like I'm away from home or from, you know, Paso that often, you know.
And what has shaped you into the person that you are?
I don't know how much time you got. No, I'm just kidding. There's a lot of things I think that have been like the biggest contributors. One of the first things I'll probably say is that, you know, my parents did raise me up in the faith. So they raised me up to be Christian, in particular Catholic. And so that's been a very big part of my upbringing since I was like a little kid, right? And that's kind of followed me into adulthood. Furthermore, I've gotten a chance to do a lot of really amazing, or not amazing, but like a chance to do like a lot of, things as far as creativity goes. My parents always like really allowed me to like, you know, like pursue like a lot of these interests, like piano, like art, guitar and stuff like that. And because of that, it's helped me to kind of make a whole second career out of music and painting as well. So I would probably say like all like the arts, my faith, as well as my parents. My parents had a very big impact on me.
And what do you want people to know about who you are now?
If we're being completely honest, I think like if you asked me this question like 8 or 9 months ago, I'd probably say like, oh, like I'm a musician, even before I'm like a teacher. But since the pandemic hit and, you know, things like changed so much, it kind of like helped me to realize, you know, I'm a lot more than just a musician. So I think like if you know, if you ask me like who I am right now, I would say I have a much more general answer like, I don't even know how to explain it. Like, I guess I would just hope that people would see me as like a genuine person who happens to be a teacher, who happens to be a musician, and happens just to be trying his best at life just like everybody else, and someone who loves animals a lot.
And how did you feel in mid-March when life first started to change because of COVID in the U.S.?
Sure. So, you know, when it first started, you know, I was a little nervous, but at the time, none of us really thought how long this was going to go for. So I was kind of excited. I was like, man, we get an extra like week or two for spring break and I have to lesson plan. Oh, this is fantastic. That was obviously not the case, but when it first started, I wasn't really super scared or nervous. I was just okay, you know, it's something I take care of for a couple weeks, then it'll be done with. But you know, here we are.
And how did your feelings evolve within like the following weeks and months of the pandemic?
Yeah, so as it continued to drag more and more, you know, because like I do live by my own, it's before I even got like my cat Catalina, you know, because you do live alone. I think as time went on, I started to get like a lot less motivated for sure. A lot more, you know, battling things like depression and stuff like that because you're alone all the time. And at the time, music was very hard to kind of pursue because of what was going on. So that was like a really big outlet. And even though I still played music all the time and even more, you know, it just felt like I didn't really get to share it with as many people, which kind of bugged me a lot.
It was seemed normal before COVID-19, this seems strange to you now.
What seems normal? What was normal before COVID-19 that's strange to me now?
Yes.
I don't want to give a cliche answer. I would probably say the fact that like every time like I watch like a movie, and I see people in the movie like walking around like a mall or like anywhere without like a face mask, like immediately I'm like, dude, like what's your problem? Like why aren't you wearing a mask? But that's what my head thinks. But it's like it's a movie, to see videos of people at concerts, like it just seems so weird to me because it's like you get so used to having masks around that just it's like the new normal, you know?
Yeah, I agree. In the first months of the pandemic, how did COVID-19 change your plans from what you had planned?
So the biggest plans I had were actually as a musician. I had like six gigs lined up. I had a music festival I was gonna play. I had so much I wanted to do, but it was all immediately canceled. It was what time when I was getting really into like or getting a lot of momentum with my music as far as like the local scene goes. So it was very disappointing that some of my live performances and some momentum I got was just thrown out of whack. However, I will say that because of it kind of pushed me to do other things in music that didn't require me to be around other people. Like I got in talks with like a website person, so now I have my own website. I was able to get that professionally done. It came out really well. I talked to one of my friends and worked on merchandise ex design, so you know, have merchandise for my for like my music, and that came out well. So I had to switch pretty much all my music plans to an online kind of sphere. So, you know, it worked out in the end, but I definitely wish I could have played some of those shows.
And how was that experience like? Was it like an easy transition to do everything like virtual? Were you able to do anything virtual, like virtual concerts?
So I did do some virtual concerts. You know, when this pandemic first started, everybody was like, yeah, let's do virtual concerts, you know, get people in better spirits. But I'm gonna be honest with you. I actually don't like virtual concerts. I just don't. So, you know, I would be in some of these concerts and it would go well, but it's just the reactions or the engagement just a lot lower. So yeah. But now these days, I don't really see like a lot of like local musicians doing as many virtual concerts because I feel like people have kind of gotten numb to like the virtual concerts and stuff like that. So,
And has there been like local like small concerts in San Antonio? Like now after like the whole at first it was like oh like everyone was panicking about the pandemic, but now it's kind of like oh this is the new normal. Have you seen anything like that?
yeah, definitely. I do see people playing. Their shows are going on again. Personally, I haven't really tried to get back into that scene yet, because I actually had some health issues kind of come up with my voice like last semester. And aside from that, I'm also not really comfortable yet, like inviting people out to con like I don't mind playing, you know, because it's like my own health that I'm risking, but I feel weird. Inviting like my friends, my fans to come out to a show where they could possibly get hurt. So I just, yeah, I haven't done any live concerts because of that yet.
And early in the pandemic, what concerned you the most about the coronavirus?
At the very beginning, there was still so much, I mean, there's still so much unknown about it now, but I guess what concerned me the most is that I would get the virus, get very sick, and have no ways to get food because I live alone. All my family's in other places, and everybody that I knew kind of went back to their homes. I was scared that I wasn't going to have any way to get food. I was also scared that I was going to be a person who got very sick, and there wasn't going to be any space in the hospital for me. So just like basically like survival stuff is what I was concerned most about. Not so much for my job because they were semi lenient on it, so I wasn't as concerned about it. Mostly just like survival stuff.
And I know you mentioned that you're a teacher at a high school here in San Antonio. How did COVID-19 affect your job?
Oh man, a lot actually. So there's a bunch of issues that COVID brought up for my job. The ways it affected me personally is that I had to basically switch all my lessons to an online platform, which is not conducive to learning as well, at least as much as like in person. So basically we use Zoom. We used other forms of like online stuff to kind of get our lessons done. But the reality is that the school I teach at is not a school that is very affluent, so we always struggled pretty heavily with resources. So our attendance during class is just it's really bad. Like I'm very lucky to have 50 to 60% attendance on a day in class, even to this day, because it's high school and like students have so much more on their minds than having to complete schoolwork, understandably so. So that's been a very big struggle. Now what's kind of happened is that we have started to bring students in to do like a hybrid kind of thing. So I do have students in my classroom now, which is cool. But the only issue is that the majority of my students are still online, so I can't really teach in person because I can't do two lessons at the same time. So I basically have to teach online while I kind of just facilitate the learning of the students who are in front of me. So that's been like a big change.
I totally agree with that. I'm doing my student teaching this semester, at elementary, and we're still having to teach through Zoom. We still have students in the classroom, but everything has to be through Zoom. So
Yeah.
it's a challenge.
Definitely.
And how has COVID-19 affected the employment of the people you know?
So I've been very fortunate. My parents are a little bit older, so my dad's already retired. My mother is a loan officer, so people still needed homes even during COVID-19, so like she still had her job secured. The people that suffered the most probably my friends. So my very, very, very good friends. I did have a few of them get laid off, or what I think there's a term. It's called like furlough or something like that, when like someone gets laid off for COVID. I think that's what it's called, but a lot of them got laid off. A lot of different career changes has happened with a lot of my friends. Like they've actually have had like two or three friends start to become the process to start to become teachers now because of COVID. So that was kind of funny.
And what do you think or hope will happen to your job in the future?
I hope that after COVID gets under control and that we can bring in the full capacity of students again. I hope that first of all, we can get back to that safely. Second off, I really hope that this experience, that we learn something from this experience, and that our leaders in the district, with the district I'm in, with our leaders in the school, with teachers and with students, that we all learn from the experience, to really kind of understand how to create like an equitable education for more students, because this pandemic has completely exacerbated all the kind of disparities that are sometimes under the radar with our students. So it's really kind of shown like some huge areas of need that we just have to do better in as like teachers, as school leaders, as district leaders and stuff like that.
Yeah, I agree. How has COVID-19 affected you and your daily activities?
So during the school day, not that much. It's not that much difference because I still have to like go to work during the day now. When COVID first started, basically I would sleep in a lot more. I would do a whole lot of painting because I'm like a commissioned painter. Do music all the time. I was just living like the same day over and over again. Hold on, I'm so sorry. Come on, Catalina. Oh. I was living like the same day over and over again. Kind of like, it was like kind of like that movie Groundhog Day. You know, you wake up, everything's the exact same thing over and over and over again. And don't get me wrong, it was very nice to have a break from, you know, the grind, but it got very old very quickly.
And what are you doing now? Are you like staying in still? Are you going out, or what are you doing to pass your time?
Sure. So just recently, I actually got done with like my vocal therapy, so I can start singing again, which is really cool. So I finally started to be able to write music and like get back into music. I've been doing a lot of painting, so much so that since I couldn't do music for like the past 2 or 3 months, I decided to kind of like really get going with like my painting, and a lot of people have actually really enjoyed it, and I'm getting like commissions like very frequently to like do paintings for people. So I've just been getting back into painting, getting back into music, lesson planning, exercising quite a bit now. I just feel like I have like a really good routine. I just feel like I'm kind of like settled in. As far as like what I'm doing, like going out and stuff, I don't really go out. I don't go to restaurants. I just go to work and come home. There is like a very, very, very small bubble of people that I do allow myself to see, but that bubble's like 3 people sometimes. And even then, most of the time, like we're very safe. So, I mean, that's kind of how it's going.
And has COVID-19 changed your relationship with your family?
I think so. I do think so, because, you know, things like world events like this tend to bring people closer together. So I do think that, like, you know, talking on the phone so much with my parents and my family, it has brought us closer together, because, you know, we lived in different cities. So it's not like we were cramped in the same house together. If we're in the same house together, I don't know if our relationship would have gotten better, but, you know, I think it has gotten a little bit better.
And following up with that, have you changed how you see and communicate with your friends and family?
Yes, definitely. I find myself using, like just talking to them a lot more in an online world. I will say that, I don't know if it's because of COVID, but you know, I did have like something else like my throat a while back. So for like the past couple months, it's been rough to kind of like call people. So I've almost always had to like text message people. So that's kind of like how it's changed. It's been mostly text messages for the past couple months, but just increased phone communication.
And what have been the biggest relationship challenges that you have faced during COVID-19?
I think keeping in touch with the people that you saw every day, it's so hard to maintain relationships sometimes. You don't speak to people as much, and it's so hard to reach out to people sometimes because, you know, you can't reach out to everybody over the phone, and the people that you saw in person, like those, that was the time that you had to like reach out to them, check up on them, and we don't see them in person. Now suddenly you have like a huge group of people that, you know, you need to check in on with on the phone and online. And it just takes up so much cognitive load just to like really be able to like do that. So that's been pretty difficult. Dating has been horrible during COVID. So I would probably say romantic relationships have been very difficult. Impossible, I would say, non-existent, but also the friends thing as well.
And how has COVID-19 affected your community?
As far as community, I'm going to stick with my school community, because the community that I'm with, like around like where I live, I don't know too much about like the people I'm around. I know more about like my school community in the area over there. So, the school community, I would say that it has gotten like a huge like a cult the culture has shifted pretty heavily to like kind of like reprioritize like what's important, what's necessary in our lives. So I will say that I've had students kind of message me saying that, hey, Mr. Montenegro, I can't go to class like at all because I'm taking care of like my family. So like there's been like a lot of like strain like my students and their families. I think a lot of strain in the community. There's been a big number of closings of stores and restaurants in around my school's area that have been kind of rough. So it's impacted my community financially, culturally, and educationally as well.
And how are people around you responding to those changes?
So I would say that some people are taking it to like find like another hobby. A lot of people I know are starting to get like what's called like side hustles, you know, where they find like a new way to like make money and stuff like that. I see a lot of that happening. Yeah, everybody has side hustles these days. Everybody kind of has to find like a new restaurant. I feel like people talk way more about what they miss. I feel like nostalgia is much more prevalent these days, stuff like that.
And have you seen the people around you change their opinions or day-to-day activities due to the pandemic?
Yeah, definitely. I think that in general, like all of us have gotten much more or less active in general. Like you know, when you stay in home, we stay at home for most of the time, you know, it's very hard to like get out of that rut. You know, it's kind of like that the law of physics where an object in motion stays in motion, and the opposite is also true. So I think people have become a lot less active.
And have you done any work or volunteering to help out your community members?
Yeah, so I try to do some stuff with the school. It's mostly like just like school related stuff, like extracurricular stuff, for, like the students in
Yeah.
particular. Like as far as like community goes, I've just done like the basic stuff, help with the food drives, collect, like donate clothes and stuff like that. So I've donated resources more than actual like time during this pandemic, which I feel like is pretty common because. Donating time sometimes means that you have to like be around other people, which is kind of be
Yeah.
nerve-wracking sometimes.
Have you or anybody you know gotten sick during the COVID-19 pandemic?
Actually, yeah. So I've had like, let me see, one, two, I had like eight people I've known gotten COVID. And two of them were in my bubble group, and I was very nervous, but I've never gotten COVID, thankfully. But I actually had a very big scare where on my birthday in December, it was like the one time I actually saw somebody. And they came over, we had dinner. And then the next day they told me that they felt weird. And then they tested positive for COVID. I'm like, wow, okay. So I had to get tested for COVID. I got tested like three times just to make sure. The lab test, it all came out negative. I still had to stay home from work for 14 days. So it was just kind of weird how COVID kind of works because I was literally across the table from this person for like a solid 2 hours and I didn't get it. And I just don't know why, you know, it's strange.
And how was that experience like when you got your COVID test? I know some people say that it was the worst experience they've had, and then some people say it's not too bad. So how was yours like?
Just felt, I think so. I mean, I didn't think it was, I mean, it didn't feel nice, but it was just something like, yeah, like it's something I kind of have to do. I got tested as often as I could because I know, like, sometimes like there's like an incubation period. So it hurt, but it wasn't horrible. Yeah. It just made me sneeze. It's like you have something like really far up in your nose, but.
And how worried are you about getting the virus?
At the start of this pandemic, I would say a solid 8.5, maybe even a 9. Right now, I've had so many friends get it, so many people I know at school, that it's just like you just get fatigued of like just worrying about it. So I still take all like the precautions, but I'm not really scared of it. I just feel like if I get it, you know, I'm just gonna deal with it if it comes. Hopefully it doesn't, but I'll probably say I'm like at a 3.5 right now on like the fear scale. Like I'm not really afraid of it anymore because it's just been here for so long. You're just like, you can't live in fear forever, right?
Yeah. And how do you think COVID-19 is affecting people's mental health?
Pretty severely, right? Definitely not for the best. Especially if you're in a house with somebody that you don't want to be with, I can imagine that can be very stressful. Furthermore, I can also imagine that can contribute a lot to depression, anxiety disorders, and stuff like that. So, definitely not in a very good way.
And how do you handle your stress when the pandemic started, and how has it changed?
So it's pretty standard. I mostly do music to kind of handle the stress, music and painting, anything kind of creative. I just like to create something. It just kind of takes my mind off of it. I like to spend time with people, but that's been kind of hard. So I haven't really been doing that. Just mostly music, painting, sometimes cooking. Sometimes I manage stress by cleaning, going for a run, exercising, going mountain biking and stuff like that. So like pretty basic stuff, nothing like interesting.
What are you most looking forward to when the pandemic is over?
Playing music at shows again, I think. And being able to go up to my friends and family without fear. And there's like this meme. Yeah, there's like this meme that I saw, like it shows like two people, like two like figures next to each other, and there's like a bunch of like particles coming out from their mouth and it's like hitting each other like really badly. And then the meme says something like, "Me and the homies blasting each other with particles once this pandemic is over." I can't wait to blast particles at my friends after this pandemic is over.
Has technology played a role in your life during the pandemic? I know there was like a lot of new games that came out and apps. So did it help you or?
Yeah, definitely. So I got really big into like video editing because since I'm a musician, all the like the marketing stuff I do, I have to kind of do on my own. So I've kind of edited a lot of like really good videos for marketing that have done really well. I also use TikTok. I don't know if TikTok's gonna be a thing 20 years from now. That'd be kind of funny if someone's listening to this 20 years and they see TikTok. But basically, I use TikTok pretty heavily to reach out to people to like use my music in their videos. It actually went really well, and I had a song release back in July during the pandemic, and because of like all the technology from my video editing software, from reaching out to people on TikTok and using just the technology to promote it, it did really well, even though we're in a pandemic.
That's awesome. And how much time do you spend on TikTok?
I actually don't. I when I first got it, oh my gosh, I spent hours and hours and hours. But now I don't really spend that much time. Yeah, I actually moved it like off of like my because on the new iPhone that we have right now, it has that thing where you can move an app like in like to the app library, so it's not anywhere on the screen. So I still have it, but I moved it to like the app library so I don't use it as much.
No, I agree. Like, even I still do sometimes where I'm like, I'm just gonna watch TikToks for 2 minutes, and then 2 minutes turns into 2 hours.
Famous last words, right? I also got this little one during quarantine. Her name's Catalina. It's really cute. She's still a kitten, but yeah, she's been keeping me company.
That's good. Yeah, I also got a dog like 2 months ago, the dachshund.
Oh.
Develop separation anxiety.
Yeah. I wanted to get a dog, but unfortunately my apartment's not like the biggest apartment, so I only know I like big dogs, so I want to get like a German Shepherd.
Oh, okay.
I don't have time for a German Shepherd because I'm a teacher and my apartment isn't big enough, so I rescued Catalina and things have been going well.
That's good. Where have you been getting your news from during the pandemic?
Yeah, so I get my news mostly from like the little. So basically, the ones I go to most are the New York Times, probably CSN, CNN, MSNBC. and my friends, probably those four people. Yeah. I'm not a huge news person, but just probably those four places. I used to get from TikTok a lot, but I thought that wasn't the best idea, so I stopped.
What do you think of how the pandemic is being covered in the news?
I think when it first started, it's very ironic. If you look at like the news stories, you know, when it first started, the news were, you know, definitely like kind of like stoking fear, which is like understandable. But it was back when the pandemic wasn't as serious as it is now. But there seems to be like a lot less stories about the pandemic because kind of people have kind of settled into it. But it just kind of seems strange that when it first started, when there was much, much fewer deaths and cases, the news was freaking out about it. And then now that like an incredible, horrific number of people have died and gotten sick, like there's not as much coverage just because it's been here for so long. I guess that's understandable. It's just like expected at this point, like, hey, COVID's bad. Like, what do you want us to tell you kind of thing?
What have local leaders done in your community in response to the pandemic? And what do you think of their response?
So going to back to like my school, my district, I go back and forth on how my district has responded to it. Our district superintendent has helped us out a little bit with like having sick days for COVID, with allowing like certain like things, but you know, we don't have as much money as other places. So, you know, other school districts here in San Antonio that are more wealthy, they've been able to do other stuff like give students better technology, give teachers better like hazard pay or any kind of bonuses to help out with like maybe cut back hours and stuff like that. And we really haven't gotten anything like that. So I think that the response from leaders has not been very consistent. It has been kind of very independent of each other. Sometimes there is a precedent that is set, but most of the time people just kind of make their own decisions as far as like the school communities go. So it's been, some school districts have done very well here. Other ones have not.
I agree. Yeah. Do you have any thoughts on how the pandemic has been handled in the U.S. or any other country?
Yeah, I don't like how it's been handled in the U.S. I feel like it's a pretty big shared sentiment from a lot of people living here right now. Definitely a lot of people who don't take it as seriously as they should. And obviously, you know, with the really historic mess that's been going on in like politics up in like Washington, D.C. with like the presidency, yeah, there's been a lot of misinformation and relaxation that really shouldn't have been like allowed during like this time. But, you know, it's just like a perfect storm. So I don't think it's been handled very well in the U.S. I think it's been handled well in other countries, some of them, but yeah, not well here.
If you could go back in time and talk to yourself before the pandemic, what would you tell yourself?
Stop eating out, cook more. Probably save myself some time and tell myself those lyrics that I was trying to write for like the longest time, like one song. I'll just go back in time and just tell my former self what those actual song lyrics were, so don't waste 2 weeks of my life.
And how has the pandemic changed who you are and how you see the world now?
It's very cliche, but it's really, really set into my head that, you know, I'm really not entitled to anything. You know, I can't take anything for granted, because literally at any moment, something can change. So to have a lot of stuff happen this year, you know, just have a family member pass away, not from COVID, but from other stuff. I had really bad issues with my voice where it hurt to talk. I couldn't even sing. And like a lot of stuff happened, you know, during this, like this 2020 worst year ever, right? That it really puts things into perspective and just really drives home the fact that, you know, nothing is guaranteed in life. And it's so cliche. People say it all the time, But you know, you don't really understand it until like you understand it. And I feel like this year has kind of helped me to understand that phrase a lot more.
And do you think the pandemic will have a lasting effect on the world?
I actually hope so. I really do. I do hope that, you know, we learn from this experience. I hope that it has a positive lasting effect. And I think that it will. I really do, because this was such a long, this is still going on such a long period of time. I do think that there's going to be hopefully some kind of like hazard measures that will be put in place in like our local state, country, and even like world organizations to be better prepared for something like this. I hope it also it opens up a lot more conversations about people's well-being and like priorities that are set by companies, by people, by schools and stuff like that. So I hope so.
I agree. Thank you so much for giving us your time and participating in this oral research project. Do you have any last few words you want to share with us?
So this is going to be up in 20 years, right?
Yes, it's going to stay in the UTSA oral history.
Well, I don't know if anybody's going to happen upon this interview, but if it ever does, I guess I just want to say hello. I hope I did something with music in this life. I hope that you'll be able to listen to my music, and I'd be really curious to see if you can still look at my music 20 years from now. That's about it. Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for giving us your time.
Yeah. Thank you.